to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The Gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
The Bible says, contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. Jude verse 3. We welcome you today to our study of Answering Denominational Doctrines. In this series of lessons, we're going to look at various doctrines promoted by men and then simply compare them with the Word of God and see if they are true to the Bible. As always, we're so glad that you've joined us for our study together today. We want to encourage you to locate your Bible and get that handy as we're going to be searching through the Scriptures together to let God and His Word be the final authority. We want to encourage you in your local area to visit the Lord's Church, the Church of Christ. These lessons are being brought to you by members and congregations of the Church of Christ, and they would love for you to stop by and visit their assemblies. If you've got a Bible question or would like to study the Word of God further, they'd be more than happy to help you in that way. And friend, at the Gospel of Christ, we'd also like to help you in your study of the Word of God. We encourage you to visit our website, thegospelofchrist.com. All our lessons, as well as a host of other good Bible study material, is located on our website and is free of charge. And friend, we also encourage you to check out our apps, both on the Android and the Apple Store. For your smartphone, those are a good tool to study the Word of God on the go as well, and we want to encourage you to look into those. As we think today about the idea of answering denominational doctrine, this lesson is going to specifically deal with a very popular false doctrine, once saved, always saved. But before we actually get into thinking about that doctrine or teaching, we want you to understand three things from the outset that are very important as to our motivation. First and foremost, please realize that the purpose in presenting these lessons is not to belittle, not to demean, not to be unkind in any way, but rather these lessons are motivated out of a love for three things. First of all, we present these lessons out of a love for our God. God loved man so much, He gave His own Son, John 3:16. He gave us the plan of salvation, and one day He's coming back to redeem His own. And Jesus wants us to live in harmony with His will. We present these lessons not only out of a sincere love for God, but also out of a sincere love for the truth. Friend, it is the truth that will set us free. John 8, verse 32, the truth is the Word of God. John 17, verse 17, and so regardless of what man thinks, it is the truth that will save. And then please hear us well today. These lessons and this series of lessons is also being presented out of a love for souls. Friend, we want you to know up front that we are concerned about men and women's souls more than anything. We want men and women to be saved. We want people to go to heaven. And the Bible teaches that the truth, that God's Word, and that knowing, living, and obeying that is essential to being right with God. And error will only keep people from knowing God's truth. And so please understand these three loves that we have from the outset of our lesson. Now, as we mentioned, in today's lesson, we're going to be thinking about the false doctrine of once saved, always saved. It may also be known by other terminologies, the perseverance of the saints, or the idea, as some will label it, that you can't fall from grace. basically, this doctrine is saying that once you become a child of God, once you become a Christian, you cannot so sin as to ever be lost. Once you've obeyed the gospel, you can never again do anything to lose your salvation. No matter what you do, you can never be lost again. And friend, while from the outset that may have a sense of pseudo-comfort, is that idea really true? Let me help us understand this doctrine by defining it according to a couple of well-known sources that have been used. How far does this doctrine go? Friend, Baptist preacher Sam Morris, in a tract entitled, "Do a Christian Sin's Damn His Soul," said this about once saved, always saved. He said, "We take the position that a Christian's sins do not damn his soul. The way a Christian lives, what he says, his character, his conduct, or his attitude toward other people have nothing whatsoever to do with the salvation of its soul. All the prayers a man may pray, all the Bibles he may read, all the churches he may belong to, all the services he may attend, all the sermons he may practice, all the debts he may pay, all the ordinances he may observe, all the laws he may keep, all the benevolent acts he may perform will not make his soul one whit safer. And all the sins," now listen to this, "and all the sins he may commit, from idolatry to murder, will not make his soul in any more danger. Salvation is settled once and for all when we believe. The way I live has nothing whatsoever to do with the salvation of my soul." Did you hear that? All the sins you can make me, whether it's idolatry, whether it's murder, whatever it may be, this man says and properly defines the terms by saying, when you become a Christian, there is no sin that you can commit that will ever cause you to be lost. That's kind of the idea behind this doctrine. Or to put it another way, this doctrine's been around for a long time. In fact, Bill Foster, preacher back in the 1950s, denominational preacher back in the 1950s, stated in the Weekly Informer in March of 1952, he said this about once saved, always saved. He said, "If I killed my wife and mother and debauched 1,000 women, I couldn't go to hell. In fact," he said, "I couldn't go to hell if I wanted to." Now friend, that sounds a little too much for most people. For most, that would probably take it too far. But this is the natural, logical conclusion of once saved, always saved. If I'm saved and I can never be lost, no matter what I do, rape, murder, killing people, I couldn't go to hell if I wanted to. Now friend, that's the logical conclusion of this teaching. But let's ask a more important question. This is the question that we are considering today. What does the Bible say on the subject of once saved, always saved? Is this a biblical doctrine? Does the Word of God support this? Are there any passages, teachings that will help us to understand whether this is true or not? Friend, as we mentioned from the outset today, we're going to look to the Word of God. We're going to ask the great question of Jeremiah 37, verse 17, is there any word from the Lord? Or as Paul stated it in Romans 4, verse 3, what does the Scripture say? Our authority is not going to be men, not going to be various writers of doctrinal teachings. It's not going to be ourselves. Our authority is going to be the Word of God. And friend, I hope you'll listen real carefully to this first passage. Here's what's great about the Bible. Friend, God, in the exact language that false teachers use, actually says that one can fall from grace. Men and women today who promote this idea of once saved, always saved, use the terminology that you can't fall from grace. And yet God in the Bible, in the very first passage we're going to look at, tells Christians they had fallen from grace. I want you to take your New Testament and look with us to Galatians chapter 5. I want you to notice verse number 4. The Apostle Paul is writing to Christians and to the church in Galatia. We learn that in Galatians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, that he's writing to the church and to Christians. And notice what he says in Galatians 5, verse 4. Paul says to these Christians, "You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by law, you have fallen from grace." Listen to that wording that Paul uses. Paul says, "You've become estranged from Christ," which means literally, you've been severed or cut off from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by law, you have fallen from grace. Did you hear that? Men and women today will say a Christian can't fall from grace. And yet the Apostle Paul, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, said to Christians, "You have fallen." Literal Greek word there is ek, out of grace. And so when you think about this idea, it's very clear that some who were Christians did something that caused them to lose their soul. Now the context is very important because Paul is writing to Christians who of some of those are now trying to go back to the old law and bring in things from the old law. Maybe you're a Christian and yet you're trying to bring in circumcision. Paul says, if you do that, you have become cut off from Christ, you have fallen from grace. And so think about this idea with me. Can a Christian so sin as to be lost? Paul, writing to Christians who were attempting to bring in the old law, said, "You have fallen from grace." Logically saying it or stating it, we could put it this way. A Christian can attempt to bring in teachings of the old law. Bringing in those teachings of the old law would be wrong and therefore would cause him to fall out of God's grace. Now, I want to mention a couple of words here that are very important. When Paul says in Galatians 5, verse 4, "You have become estranged from Christ." What's that word "estranged" means? Literally, it means you've been cut off. You have been severed. You have been decapitated. Might be a good word way of thinking about that. It's as though you've got a limb and that limb is severed, cut off. Well, from who? From Christ. Men and women, people today, please understand that false doctrine separates us from Christ. Now that word "from" at the end of the verse, Paul says, "You have fallen from grace," literally is the Greek word ek, and it means out of. It's not as though Christ is here and you've just moved yourself a little away from Him. You're literally out of the realm of God's grace. Can a man be saved without God's grace? Absolutely not. Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, and yet that's the place these Christians find themselves in Galatians chapter 5, verse 4. And so in using the exact language of false teachers, Paul said to Christians, "You have fallen from grace." Friend, it's clear that a Christian can so sin as to fall from grace. But you know, if we were really going to convince someone, help people to understand and see that the idea of once saved, always saved is not true, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could show a clear example of someone who was saved by an apostle of God, fell into sin, and was told by that same inspired apostle he was lost? Well, friend, that's exactly what we find in the New Testament. I want you to be opening your Bible to Acts chapter 8. In the 8th chapter of the book of Acts, we're going to learn about Simon the sorcerer. And basically, as we think about Simon, the Bible tells us that Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached the gospel to them. Simon hears that message, he believes, and is baptized also. And as we follow the story through, Simon had been a sorcerer, a magician, in his former life. In obeying the gospel, he turned to Christ, turned from sin, and was baptized into the body of Christ. But as he sees that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, Acts 8, 18, he sees through the laying on of the apostles' hands, the gift of the Holy Spirit is given, here's what Simon says. Simon says, "Give me that gift also. On whomever I lay my hands, they may also receive the Holy Spirit." And so Simon, for wrong motives, Peter tells him he sinned. Now watch what happened. Here's a man who just obeyed the gospel, just became a Christian. It's as though he's still wet after coming out of the waters of baptism. Look at what the Bible says. Peter's response to him in Acts chapter 8. And I want you to notice specifically verse number 20. What did Peter say to Simon? Peter said to him, "Your money perish with you, for you thought the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter. Your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this, your wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you." Oh, here's Simon, just obeyed the gospel, just became a Christian. He reverts back to his old life, tries to buy the Holy Spirit, which would have been completely against the will of God and sinful. But friend, here's what I want you to notice. Peter said to him, "Your money, don't miss this, perish with you." Did you get that? Peter said, "Your money's going to perish, and it's going to perish with you." What did Peter say to Simon? "Simon, you're lost. Your money's going to be lost, and you're in a lost state right now." Friend, this is the clearest, one of the clearest case examples to prove that once saved, always saved is not true. Now just think about what you've got here. You've got a man who no doubt was a Christian. You've got a man who no doubt, as a Christian, sinned. Peter said, "What you've done is wickedness." Peter later will say, "You're in the bond of iniquity and the gall of bitterness." Wickedness and sin are identified. A man who's a Christian, the Bible identifies that man sinned. And friend, the Bible tells that man that because of his state, he is going to be lost. Your money perish with you. And sort of what do we know from this example? A Christian can so sin as to perish or be lost. Friend, that is clear, that's plain, that's simple from the Word of God, and it's a clear example for us today. But let me give you some other examples that also help us to understand this. In writing to the church in Corinth, to Christians and to the church in Corinth, the Apostle Paul encourages them not to get caught up in sin as well. And he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12, "Take heed lest ye fall." Now, friend, I want you to think about this for a moment. Think about the logic of this. Paul said, "Be careful, watch out, lest you fall." Now, Paul, what do you mean by fall? Well, some would say, well, fall really doesn't mean be lost or be severed from God. It's not what the context teaches. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 10 tells us exactly what that means, defines it as being destroyed by the destroyer. Being separated and lost from God is the idea. And Paul says, "I'm giving you this Old Testament example so that you can watch out and not fall and be lost as some of them were." Friend, can you think about that idea for just a moment in view of once saved, always saved? If once saved, always saved is true, if a man can never fall from grace, what in the world does 1 Corinthians 10, 12 mean? If you can't fall, why would Paul say to Christians, "Take heed lest you fall"? You see, the ideas, the doctrine of men is not in accord with the doctrine of God. A person can so sin as to be spiritually destroyed and fall from grace. God doesn't want it to happen. We don't want it to happen. But denying the reality, friend, doesn't do anybody any favors and is not true from the Word of God. Now, here again is another clear example of someone who was a Christian. We mentioned Simon. This would be the second clear example of someone who is a Christian and had the possibility of getting caught up in sin and being lost. A rather graphic example. Would you open your Bible to 2 Peter chapter 2 with me? I want you to see this example as it relates to the idea of once saved, always saved. 2 Peter chapter 2, and I want you to notice what Peter says. Again, Peter's writing at the outset of the book. Peter tells us that he is writing to those of like precious faith, writing to Christians, and here's what he says to them. 2 Peter chapter 2, look in verse 20 through 21. The Bible says, "For if, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better for them, having not known the way of righteousness, than having known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them, according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow having washed to her wallowing in the mire. Peter's describing Christians who are going back into sin. And he says, if after they've escaped the pollutions of the world, meaning through the Lord Jesus Christ and His sacrifice, they've obeyed the gospel, become a Christian, come out of sin. If after they've escaped all that, they're entangled, caught up in it again, trapped in sin, Peter says the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. How, if a Christian can never fall from grace and be lost, how can that latter end be worse for them? Friend, the latter is worse because now they've tasted how good it is to be a Christian. Now they know what it means to be forgiven of sin. Now they've been cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and still they chose to go back into that and be lost eternally. How do we know that it's a horrible, grotesque predicament? Well, listen to the language that's used in verse 22. What's it like when a Christian gets involved in sin, goes back into the world and is lost? It's as though, and you can just hear this language and how it turns your stomach. It's as though a sow, having been washed, returns to her wallowing in the mire, or a dog returns to his own vomit. That's disgusting. Imagine a pig. You take that hog, you clean it up, you shine it up, you get it out of the pig pen. It looks pretty, but what happens the minute you let it back in that pen? It slops in the mud all over again. God says that's what a Christian is like. Unclean, in a lost, sinful, dirty, grotesque state all over again. And so this passage again clearly teaches that a Christian can become entangled in sin again and end up in a worse, lost state because now he's known the truth and knows how good that truth was. But then we also think of a passage in which Jesus instructs the church of the Lord Jesus Christ in the book of Revelation and tells them some very important things here as well. I want you to look at Revelation chapter 3, verse number 5. Notice these words, Revelation 3, verse 5. The Bible is going to say this to the church that Jesus instructs in this epistle. Jesus says to them in verse 5, "He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments. I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess His name before My Father and before His angels." Now, to be saved, we've got to be confessed by the Lord. He's got to confess our name before God. Matthew 10, verse 32 and 33. The Bible teaches that our names must be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Revelation chapter 20 teaches that idea as well. But listen to what warning Jesus gives to the church here. He says, if you overcome, you continue to be faithful, I will not blot out your name from the book of life. Friend, why would Jesus say that if the possibility of it happening does not exist? That warning, that encouragement also is a two-edged sword, meaning that if you live faithful, you're going to be in heaven, you're going to live with God, but the possibility exists that you can be unfaithful and have your name blotted out of God's book of life. And so Revelation 3 verse 5 clearly teaches this idea as well. 2 Peter 1 verse 10, Peter said, be more diligent to make your calling and election sure. Friend, if you can never be lost, what in the world does 2 Peter 1:10 mean? Why would I need to make my calling and election sure if I can't be lost? Well, again, there's a multiplicity of passages that teach this is not true. But let me for just a couple of minutes address one of the main passages that is misused as it relates to the idea of once saved, always saved. Would you turn your Bible to 1 John chapter 3? Many proponents of the false doctrine of once saved, always saved will use passages like 1 John 3 verse 9. Notice these words. John says, whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he's been born of God. And so people will look at this passage and say, you cannot sin. It's impossible for you to sin once you become a child of God. Well, friend, we've already seen that's not true from other Bible passages, and John is going to teach that it's not true. 1 John 1 verse 8. If we say we have no sin, we make God a liar. John's already said, some people take this the idea that you just can't sin. And John's already said, if we say that, we make God a liar. Jesus is the propitiation for our sins. 1 John 2 verses 1 and 2. Well, what does 1 John 3 verse 9 mean? What's it talking about? Friend, the Greek word for sin is a present tense verb. And it carries the idea of keep on sinning or practicing sin. In fact, a host of translations realize that and put it this way. For example, the English Standard Version says, no one born of God makes a practice of sinning. The New American Standard Updated Version says, no one who is born of God practices. There's that idea of that continual ongoing action. Practices sin. The NIV says it this way, no one who is born of God will continue in sin. John is not trying to say, he's already refuted that idea, he's not trying to say that it is impossible for a Christian to commit sin. But John is saying, if you're living as a faithful child of God and trying to go to heaven, you can't live in sin. Have you thought about this? This passage actually disproves once saved, always saved. If John is saying the word is a continual action, and John is saying you can't keep on sinning, you can't practice sin, then friend, this teaches it is possible for a Christian to sin, and it is possible for a Christian to fall away from God and live in sin. And so we realize the doctrine of once saved, always saved is not supported by the Word of God. The Bible says the soul who sins will surely die. Ezekiel 18:4. John says in 1 John 1 verse 8, if we say we've got no sin, we make him a liar, and the truth is not in us. Friend, we need to realize that the possibility exists. I can sin and be separated from God. God doesn't want me to. I don't want to. Other Christians don't want me to. But ignoring the reality and the possibility is only doing detriment to my soul. And so we encourage you to check these things out in your Bible. Study the Word of God for yourself and realize God wants us to live faithful unto death and not buy in to the false doctrines of men. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the gospel of Christ.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study material, as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form. Or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905. Or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.
This is the gospel of Christ.